Let's talk about Luke chapter 15 in 5 minutes. If you want this free handout, there are links down in the description. The events of this chapter and much of the book of Luke take place during Jesus' earthly ministry. That would have been about 30 to 33 AD. There's really four main characters in this chapter. There's Jesus, of course, who's the main character of the entire book. And then there's a shepherd who loses his sheep and goes looking for him. Then there's also a woman who loses a coin and goes looking for it. And then there's a prodigal son who leaves home, takes all his money with him, and nearly ruins his life. When we ask the question, where did the events of this chapter take place, we aren't exactly sure because Luke doesn't tell us. One of the best hints that we have, though, is in chapter 13, verse 22, where it says that Jesus was going through towns and villages on his way to Jerusalem, and he was teaching on the way. I think this chapter is pretty easy to break down. I've got it broken down into three major sections, and the first one is the parable of the lost sheep. This is verses 1 through 7. The text tells us that Jesus told this parable as a response to the Jewish religious leaders who were grumbling about him spending a bunch of time with sinners. So there was this shepherd, and he had 100 sheep, but one of them got lost. And so he left the 99 that were in safety, and he went looking for the one. And when he finally found it, he got all his friends together, and they rejoiced together. And Jesus compared the rejoicing of this man and his friends to the rejoicing that goes on in heaven when a sinner repents and comes back to the safety of God's fold. The second section is the parable about the lost coin, verses 8 through 10. Jesus asked those who he was speaking to, "If a woman has 10 coins but loses one of them, quote, does she not light a lamp and sweep the house and seek diligently until she finds it?" He said that just like the shepherd, upon finding her lost coin, her and all her friends are going to get together and rejoice. And comparatively, Jesus then said, "Just so I tell you, there is joy before the angels of God over one sinner who repents." Continuing on with this theme of repenting sinners, we go on to the third section, and that's the longest section, the parable of the prodigal son, verses 11 through 32. A man, a father, had two sons, and one day his youngest son came to him and he asked him for his inheritance money. The father was probably shocked by that request, but he actually gave him what he asked for. He gave him the money, but a few days later, his youngest son took all the money and left. And while he was away, the younger son spent and wasted all of the money that he got from his father, and pretty soon he found himself broke and in despair. When he finally realized the situation that he was in, the text says that he came to his senses and he decided that he was going to go back to his father's house and just ask his father to make him a servant. That way, at least he would have something to eat. When he finally got home, his father didn't just make him a servant. He forgave him, and he ran up to him, and he hugged him, and he honored him. But this prodigal son had an older brother, and his older brother was really mad at his dad for forgiving the prodigal because of the way that he had shamed the family. But the father rebuked his oldest son and told him that this was a situation fit for rejoicing because his younger brother was, quote, dead and is alive. He was lost and is found. So in the big picture of the entire Bible, how do these stories fit in? Well, Romans chapter 3, verse 23 tells us that all men have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. At some point, all of us have been lost sheep or lost coins or prodigal sons. And the point is that God wants us, invites us, encourages us to come back to Him and to be found in the safety of the fold again. And for us, in application, how do we view people who are caught up in sin? Do we look down on them? Do we feel like we are morally superior to them? Do we want absolutely nothing to do with them or to be associated with them? You know, Jesus intentionally spent time with sinners because he wanted to show them a better life because he loved them. So are we like Jesus, or are we like the Pharisees and the scribes who really weren't interested in helping the sinners find a better way of life and find their way back to God?